What do you think is the most are the most important values and attitudes that our youth should have in order to ensure that our country continues to thrive and prosper? Thank you.
I can list them. It'll take quite some time if I explain them. But you should have the same values and attitudes that your father or your grandfather had. Are you born and bred here?
Yes.
Yeah. Your father too?
Yes.
Your grandfather?
No.
Well, your grandfather probably worked harder than your father because he came here as a migrant. As you can see, our new migrants, they push very hard to succeed in the foreign land. And it was that spirit that got us here. Had we not had people with that ruggedness, that robust attitude, we'll make it, do or die, we wouldn't have today's Singapore. I'm not sure if I go back to 1959 and start with today's generation, bred and brought up in comfort. You know, there's no discomfort from the HDB flat with an air conditioner in your room or your dining room. You walk down and you've got a covered walkway to the bus stop. You don't have to get wet. You don't even have to carry an umbrella. Or you take the MRT. Now that's all right, provided you keep that at the back of your mind. This place is what it is because of our effort. You cease to make that effort, you cease to be like this. Let me explain briefly what I mean by that. Your father and grandfather's generation lived a hard life. Very few people had homes of their own. In Chinatown, you have cubicles, 8 or 10 people in the room sharing 4 bunks because they do shift work, save money. So Lim Kim San, who built our HDB flats, once went to a Chinatown cubicle and the man covered himself with a blanket. Pretty warm. So he said, "Why are you with a blanket?" He said, "Because my friend is using my trousers." Now, this is a real story. It's not one of these fanciful creations of his own. Then he understood how poor we were. If you lived in those conditions and you get a flat, one room, which is what we started with, communal bathroom, communal kitchen, running hot and cold, water closet. That's from the lowest depths of the ship to a deck with a window, with a porthole and air coming in. And from that to go to a 3-room or 4-room or 5-room flat, you go up to the higher levels of the ship. And finally now we've got executive flats and condominiums. That means you're on a cruise ship at the very top. Now, I have watched my grandchildren grow up, and they are growing up much more comfortably than my children. My wife and I made sure that they became self-reliant and not somebody who would pick up the balls for them. As Prime Minister, I was given a house at Sri Temasek, so I took them there one day to play. And Sri Temasek is on high ground. They're playing with the ball rolled down. And the butler ran about 50 or 60 yards to pick up the ball and bring it back. My wife and I watched them and said, no, if we stay here for 5 years, my children will grow up believing that life is like that. And that somebody will always pick up balls for them. We stay at home. And I think that's been good for them. Now, that is the problem we face today. Many of the parents who are in these HDB flats started like the people in Chinatown. They understand what it is to be poor. Today's children do not understand what it is to be poor. But you can intellectually and emotionally understand that if you don't make the same effort, you go back to where you were. Because I was once asked to make a speech in Sydney. It was the 200th anniversary. I come from New Zealand. And at Sydney, they told me no speeches. So I made no preparation. And suddenly the chief minister stood up, made a speech. I had to reply. So I replied with what was foremost in my mind. I said, as I flew over New Zealand and watched the green fields and the sheep and the cows and the small little houses dotted around, 3 million people then, I thought to myself, if I come back in 100 years, I'll see the same scene, probably more sheep, more cows, and not much more people. And I thought to myself, what will happen to Singapore in 100 years? I don't know. Can we get the same generation, successive generations, to understand that we have built this edifice? This is a 100-story building built on an extremely narrow foundation but piled deep and structured in such a way that the winds won't blow it down. To do that, you need a people with a drive and a leadership that anticipates the future. You vote in a dud lot, even though you work hard, you'll work hard to no purpose. You know how carefully we are choosing our ministers? We throw the net wide. Not just scholars. Every successful man, before he's successful, he must have some inner drive in him, something that makes him make the right judgments in life. So we throw it across society. Finally, we put them through psychometric tests, values, attitude, life story, what, how you were brought up and so on, and your values. Some people are naturally religious. Some people are naturally socially conscious. Some are economically driven and so on. So we have a fairly good profile which reduces the risk. Then we take them in as MPs, test them out, and as junior ministers, see their mettle, see whether they can swim in the deep end of the pool. Then finally, after 2 terms, you become a minister, by which time we have seen the mettle in the man. And no other country does that, but we have ministers out of 3 million people who can talk to Chinese ministers, American secretaries of state and secretaries of treasury and so on, or any European nation, at the same level. Intellectually, we are not inferior to them, but they are just the top cream of Singapore, whereas on the other side, they are part of a pretty wide, thick spectrum of cream. So it's easy to choose. Now, we need these 2 things. Then you've got today's Singapore. Then you've got this cultural hall. Then we can sit down and talk about what will happen in 50 years. Otherwise, we'll be scratching a living. So please don't forget that.